A safety report into the 2020 tanker plane crash that killed three American firefighters in the Snowy Mountains has criticised planning by the Rural Fire Service and the plane's operator on the day the aircraft went down. Chris O'Keefe joins me in the studio. Chris, what's the investigation found?
Well, basically it's found that that plane should have never been in the air because the conditions on the fire ground on the Snowy Mountains were just way too dangerous for this plane to be flying at that time. Now, this is a Hercules C-130. This is the biggest plane that has crashed in Australian history. Now, these three gentlemen on board were all from America and they'd flown out to help with the Black Summer bushfires in 2019-2020. Now, flying just north of Cooma, but what they weren't told, and this is what the report found, is that the RFS was told by smaller planes as well as a spotter plane that was supposed to go ahead of them that all of those aircraft said it was way too dangerous to be flying anywhere near that bushfire, let alone trying to drop water on, this blaze. Mm. So then what's occurred is that without that information, the tanker has then flown into it. They've gone downloaded to drop the retardant on the bushfire. And as they've tried to come up, the wind conditions were such that, unfortunately, it stalled and then crashed into the side of the mountain there, and all three of them had perished. But the RFS has copped a bit of a whack in this report, with the ATSB, the Australian Transport Safety Bureau, saying that the RFS should have told the crew and the pilots that everyone else had bailed out from trying to fight that fire.
They are a long way from home over here to support Australia, so we're very mindful of that, and we certainly hope that the recommendations that we've able to deliver as a part of this report lead us into a situation where a situation like this is far less likely to occur in the future.
Now, we have spoken to the wife of the pilot of that tanker from the United States. We'll show you that at 6 o'clock. But, Lizzie, it is just such a tragic, tragic accident. Even almost 3 years on now, it's still very, very hard for this family.
It is very sad indeed. Thank you, Chris. Sydney commuters are being warned to prepare for another day of delays and disruptions at the station this week as the state government and union meet to reach a deal on ending the industrial action. Sophie Walsh is at North Sydney Station for us this afternoon. Soph, are we any closer to ending this stalemate?
Well, Lizzie, I'd like to say yes, but the answer is probably not. The government has offered another amended deed. This time they have agreed to separate the pay issues from the safety issues. They've also agreed to give the union everything they wanted in terms of the changes to the intercity fleet. But there is a catch. In order for that offer to stand, the union has to call off all future strikes, one of which is planned for this Wednesday. This Wednesday, the union says that if that is the case, it might not be enough notice. And even if they like the offer at this stage, the Wednesday strike will still be going ahead and it could be a bad one. They are refusing to drive any foreign-made trains, which make up 70% of the fleet.
Just take the deed. We've offered it to you. We've given you what you wanted. And unfortunately, this is a deed that's going to come at the cost of schools and hospitals and roads across New South Wales.
And stuck in the middle of this stash is, of course, the innocent commuter who is very, very fed up at this stage, Lizzie.
Yeah, Sophie Walsh there for us. The Prime Minister has today marked his first 100 days in office with a speech calling for a new culture of cooperation on the road to economic recovery. Politics reporter Rhys D'Alessandro is live with more. Rhys, who's the PM hoping to convince?
Lizzie, good afternoon. The PM has used this speech to emphasise the concept of common interest across the economy, saying employers and employees, unions and businesses negotiating win-win outcomes would be a win for the country. That's who he's trying to convince. For Anthony Albanese, today was about restating his government's agenda and setting the tone for this week's job summit, acknowledging the country is still in the middle of a COVID recovery. He said reform is the key to renewal, pointing to some of the reforms already introduced, including the government's submission for an increase to the minimum wage. He's under no illusions, though, Lizzie, it will take a lot more than a jobs summit to overcome the significant economic headwinds we now face.
None of us imagine that a two-day summit will entirely fix wages and job security. I know that when we wrap up on Friday afternoon, there will still be $1 trillion of debt, Australian families will still be struggling with the cost of living pressures. Businesses, big and small, will still need help with staff and skills. But the biggest single outcome I'm hoping for is the beginning of a new culture of cooperation.
The Council of Small Business Organisations and the nation's peak union group, the Council of Trade Unions, were on song this morning on collective bargaining in particular, striking a deal that would allow employees across different small businesses to combine to strike common pay deals with their employers.
We have a one-size-fits-all system at the moment, and currently, actually, it's not fitting anyone.
It's about finding what's fit for purpose for a particular business so that they can help on a one-by-one basis. We can help them navigate the system because right now the system is broken.
Fixing that broken system, Lizzie, top of the agenda come Thursday when the Jobs and Skills Summit gets underway.
Rhys D'Alessandro there for us in Canberra. The United States has sent two Navy warships to the Taiwan Strait, sparking furious reaction from China. US correspondent Amelia Adams has more.
This is the first time US warships have sailed through the Taiwan Strait since US House Speaker Nancy Pelosi visited the island earlier this month, defying warnings from Beijing and sparking large-scale military drills. And China is, of course, watching these two missile carriers very closely. A spokesperson for China's military command says the nation is on high alert and ready to defeat any provocations. But the Biden administration is insisting this is a routine mission. Says the US will fly, sail and operate wherever international law permits.
This is that transit, very consistent with our One China policy, very consistent with our desire to make sure that we can continue to work towards a free and open Indo-Pacific. This is consistent with that policy.
It was just a few weeks ago, Beijing was launching missiles in the waters around Taiwan in response to US delegations visiting the island, which it has long claimed is its territory. So while these warships passing through should be a pretty standard exercise, it could be cause for concern or have big implications for our region, depending on how Beijing reacts.
Former Iron Woman Bonnie Hancock finally has her feet back on dry land after completing a world record-breaking surf ski paddle around Australia. And she joins us this afternoon. Bonnie, first off, how are you feeling? How are the muscles?
Oh, that's a great question. I'm very, very sore. I feel a bit like an old woman through certain parts of my body, but I've got some physio this afternoon I'm looking forward to, and emotionally I'm still on a high, so that's sort of overcoming the pain at the moment.
Yeah, now what you've done is no small feat, and it was all for a great cause. First off, tell us what you've achieved and why you decided to do it.
Yes, so last December I set off from the shores of the Gold Coast to do a big clockwise loop around Australia and have a crack at breaking the world record to be the fastest person paddling around. So I managed to do that. We brought the world record back to Australia, and you know, raising money for Gotcha for Life is a huge part of this. So raising money to promote mental fitness and the work that they do down there with Gus Warland has been a huge part of it. And raising money for Gotcha for Life has helped me get through on the dark days as well.
Oh, it's absolutely incredible. You battled through it all on this trip. We're talking about the swell, seasickness, sharks. Tell us more about what you came up against over those 8 months.
Absolutely. So along the way, we did encounter some big sharks near Perth. My crewmate saw a big great white go underneath my ski. Fortunately, I didn't see it at the time. And in the Kimberley at the top of the country, we saw three crocodiles, one as close as 10 metres to my ski. And I hope I never see those marine creatures again. But I knew that was the risk every time I got in the water. And I tried not to think about it too much.
Oh, yeah. I can imagine the weather as well. You're battling that as well.
Yes, absolutely. We faced, we crossed straight across the Great Australian Bight. We were 500 kilometres out to sea. I was seasick for 2 weeks. I lost 8 kilos in that time. And we crossed across three weather windows. So we were 15 days out at sea, and I had to get hospitalised when I came in. So it was a really traumatic journey across there. Mm.
And I can imagine there would have been some beautiful days as well. Talk us through some of the highlights of your paddle.
Absolutely. You know, there were some beautiful sections of coastline. We have an amazing country in Australia, and up the Western Australian coast, I mean, the Ningaloo Reef was wonderful, the white sand and the blue, you know, water, and certainly the Kimberley is something special to see as well. Maybe in a surf ski, not so much, but certainly from the view of the boat.
Yeah. And tell us, Bonnie, what's next? Will you do this again?
I can safely say I'll never travel around Australia on a surf ski again. I would love to jump in a car and do it that way. We're making a documentary about the journey, and I'll be writing an autobiography. So the paddle will continue just in a bit of a different way, and I'm really looking forward to those new challenges.
Oh, Bonnie, you are incredible. Iron Woman, Superwoman, I say. Well done, congratulations. And go and put your feet up.